thank you very much. And I want to thank especially those of us in the audience here with white coats on. Unlike the doctors that went to the Rose Garden, we didn't have to borrow these. We actually, all of us, practiced medicine. And for those doctors in the Rose Garden, I want to point out a feature of these white coats. The top left-hand pocket here is just the perfect size for a copy of the U.S. Constitution. Now, last time I looked, the Constitution did not give the federal government any authority over paying for, regulating, or having anything to do with medical care, and that's what the AAPF stands for. Now, there are lots of reasons, as you've heard some already today, about why you don't want government medicine. I'm just going to mention four. The first two, cost and quality, are the two that you always hear people talking about, but quite frankly, they're not the most important two, but I'm going to mention them quickly. You know, cost is a joke. What government program have you ever known to be more cost-effective or efficient than private industry? The same government that gave you the $400 toilet seat has given you the $18 aspirin. Now, I looked that up. That's exactly what an aspirin costs in a hospital that takes Medicare, is $18. That's ridiculous. So, as Ronald Reagan said, when government is the problem, more government is not the solution. Now, the only thing you need to know about quality is this. Two prime ministers of Canada snuck across the border in the dark of night with their families to get health care here. If government medicine were so bloody wonderful, why didn't they stay home? When Boris Yeltsin of the Soviet Union needed health care, he had American-trained physicians do his surgery when he needed his heart surgery. Even then, he flew Dr. DeBakey over from Texas, who was in his 90s at the time, to supervise. Why was that? Because Boris Yeltsin knew what Ayn Rand wrote, that it's not safe to trust your life to a man whose life you've throttled. In other words, he was afraid his own socialized doctors would kill him. But the real reasons that you don't want government health care have to do with liberty and your moral compass. You know, when it comes to liberty, if you give your very health to the government, what do you have left? Because nothing. Because they're going to legislate everything from what you eat, what you drink, the air you breathe, the clothing you wear. Everything can be legislated on the basis of safety and your health. We're already seeing it. I mean, New York wants to ban salt in restaurants, so give me a break. You know, this is the kind of thing that we're going to see more and more of under a socialized health system. But what I really want to talk about, and I'm going to tell you that this is not politically correct, okay? So, but I'm known for that. It seems to me they single this out as being politically incorrect to bring up the lessons of history. But there's a very graphic lesson about government health care, and it comes from World War II. After World War II, we had the Nuremberg trials, but we also had the Nuremberg doctor trials. Karl Brandt, who was Hitler's doctor, and a bunch of other top doctors were hung because of their complicity with euthanasia and with experimentation on the Jewish prisoners of war and concentration camp victims. Now, it was the universal conclusion of the Allied prosecutors, French, British, and American, that this happened not because these German doctors were somehow genetically altered or they're intrinsically evil, but because they worked for the government. And their conclusion was, quote, we should never let doctors work for the government again. I mean, you know. Now, if you don't believe this is a problem, I want you to look at the history of Holland. In World War II, the Nazis marched in and occupied Holland and tried to get the Dutch doctors to go along with their euthanasia program. The Dutch doctors refused because they were practicing what Jane Orient just described as Hippocratic primary care type individual medicine, where they put their patients first. They weren't working for the good of the state. And what happened was they would often go to the death camps rather than practice what the Nazis wanted them to do. Now let's fast forward to today. Today, if you're under the age of 10 in the Netherlands, the number one reason you die is at the hands of your physicians. How did that happen? These are the sons, granddaughters of the doctors that went to the death camps themselves rather than do that. But today, all the medical care in the Netherlands is paid for by the government. The government decides they don't want to spend money on severely disabled children, and the doctors, God help us, are the instruments of that government policy. I never want to see that come here. Now, you know, beyond that, it's immoral to put, it makes criminals of everybody. In the Soviet Union, people had to save up shoes and food and things and bribe the doctors to buy scarce, you know, medical care, because when medical care is free, it's simply not available. And so this is a problem of liberty. It's a problem of our moral compass. It's not moral to put a gun to your neighbor's head and demand that he pay for your mother's total hip. It's no more moral when you have the government do it through taxation. Now, finally, I want to leave you with a quote. It's my favorite quote about handouts. And it's from Charlie Reese, who said, "It's no shame to surrender your freedom to a superior military force, but it is an eternal shame to surrender your freedom for a filled bowl of oatmeal and the promise of security from liars." That's what we're doing. For you doctors that want to join us and aren't members of AAPS, and anybody else who wants information, we have a free open website for everybody. It's www.aapsonline.org. Thank you, Tea Party Patriots. Thanks for coming out.